through.
Throughout the tour, Roger tried to maintain control. Finally, in Portland, he lost it in what has come to be known as the Great Kabong Incident.
I was falling apart, and my guitar wasn't staying in tune, and I just lost it. And, you know, you've seen people destroy guitars for show purposes. This was not that.
He did another kabong back in the dressing room that was right next to Nancy's head on the wall that I thought was extremely inappropriate and rather symbolic. So, you know, I grabbed her and we basically ran out of there. And it was a kind of a meltdown night.
Weeks after that incident on Halloween 1979, Roger was told by management that he'd been voted out of the band.
He told me that that everybody had decided that I should leave the band, and I just felt incredible relief and just said thank you very, very much. Tell them thank you. I'm really relieved.
Roger's dismissal was just the first shoe to drop. Within a month, the nearly 10-year relationship between Ann and Roger's brother Michael Fisher also came to an end. And while Ann and Michael, who declined to appear on this show, each have their own versions why their love affair fell apart, they agree on how it ended.
Caught you in the act, can't put up with that. Messing where you shouldn't be. I wanna hear you say you're sorry, 'cause nobody takes advantage of me.
He went off and fell in love with somebody else, and that was very devastating. And I asked him if he loved her, and he said, he thought, and he said, yes, I think I do. And that's all I needed to hear. We went to sleep after that, kind of numb. And then we woke up and we had this crazy day where we just walked around our house and just cried and climbed the walls, and then I left. And I never went back.
With both Fisher brothers gone, the Wilson sisters found themselves in charge of their own destinies for the first time. At first, the feeling was exhilarating.
We felt like, okay, now we have the power. We're gonna take control of this thing. I mean, these guys have been sort of, you know, bringing us down. So to a certain extent, we were like, come on, let's go, let's rock.
Come on, keep it up, even it up, even it up.
The result of the women taking charge was 1980's Baby LaStrange. But for the second tour in a row, Nancy's love life got in the way of the music. This time, the problem was between Nancy and Mike DeRosier.
I mean, I was in love with him, but it was a one-way street. And I was just so, so heartbroken over that. So I guess it served me right after what I did to Roger, you know, to then have my heart equally as broken and be equally as sad by somebody else. I guess the worm turns, doesn't it?
All you women better listen.
When Hart went back into the studio to record their next album, Private Audition, in the fall of 1981, the band was at a breaking point.
It seemed like everybody was off kilter. Everything that happened on that whole album seemed like it was out of whack.
I felt like a number of them weren't really up to... I just didn't think the fans would like them. I didn't like them. I didn't think they were up to our standards.
The day after Private Audition was finished, Ann and Nancy fired Mike DeRosier and Steve Fossen, leaving only Howard Leese from the original band. But firing people didn't help record sales. For the Wilson sisters, it was a rude awakening on just how quickly their fortunes could turn.
Before that, all the albums had gone platinum. They were a big draw in arenas. Things were going really well, and all of a sudden, it just came to a stop. Somebody pulled the plug out.
Wake me up with laughter.
Ann, Nancy, and Howard added bass player Mark Andes and drummer Denny Carmassi and tried to pick up where they left off. They all felt their first album together, Passion Works, in 1983, was a winner.
Can a good thing last longer than a day? When do we take it now?
But their record company, Epic, didn't seem to agree. Passionworks barely cracked the top 40, and Epic didn't renew their contract.
I was thinking, well, that was great. You know, if we don't record anymore or whatever, go on and do other things, but that you could feel that if we didn't really do something, that that would probably be the end of it.
It was at that low point, when everything was at its most uncertain, that Nancy's friends fixed her up with Cameron Crowe, a rock journalist who has gone on to write and direct the films Singles and Jerry Maguire.
Well, knowing Cameron as well as I do and as I did, I knew Nancy Wilson for 5 seconds and knew that she would be Cameron's dream girl.
I certainly thought, you know, Nancy was beautiful and talented and probably taken.
Kelly said, "I've met the man who you will fall in love with and you will probably marry, and he will probably be your soulmate for the rest of your life." And I just was like, "Kelly, yeah, right. Tell me another one, you know."
But almost unbelievably, when they finally did meet, Nancy found that Kelly and Neil had gotten it exactly right.
Looking at you tonight. I was like, oh, this guy is really intelligent. He's a wunderkind. He's really funny. He's really cute. And he's not a rock guy, thank God. But he knows, he's been on rock tours, you know. So he gets the life, he knows what the life is. So how unbelievably perfect is this, you know? And 17 and a half years later, it's still perfect.
Shortly after Nancy met Cameron, Hart got another chance at the brass ring. In January 1985, they signed with Capitol Records, but some people within the company were anything but certain they had a winner on their hands.
A lot of people at Capitol, to be honest, when we were talking about signing them, said, they're old, there has been.
We were poised at that point to make one last try. You know, we knew if we didn't make a hit record, we'd probably get dropped from the label and that'd be it.
Hart's self-titled ninth album was more than a hit. It was a smash, spawning 4 top 10 singles, including Never and What About Love.
What about love? Don't you want someone to care about you?
It also gave them their first ever number one single, These Dreams.
These dreams go on when I close my eyes.
There was a week there where I think everything was number one, Hart, and the phone calls were coming in and we were talking, we just couldn't believe it, pinch me, I'm dreaming. I mean, it really was a thrill. It was great.
Hello, America.
Wiki, wiki.
Looks good.
Good. Get it.
With success came a new look, thanks to a complete makeover by some of Hollywood's best designers and photographers.
It's an incredible illusion, is what it is.
The only problem was the new look had little in common with Ann and Nancy.
It's about selling sex. A huge emphasis is put on the way a woman looks in the music business. And it became probably the most important part of selling that band for a certain period of time.
A little sprucing job.
It was nothing at all.
We've always been sexual beings on stage, but then when it becomes an expectation, then you want to rebel. Then you don't want to be a sex symbol. Then you don't want to put on the corset. Then you don't want to play dress up.
But it was too late for Ann and Nancy to rebel. They had lost their souls to corporate rock and roll.
So it's all your fault.
Man! I'm telling.